This film contains a short summary of the publicly available, but still widely unnoticed evidence for a supposed attempt to obstruct the air defense on 9/11/2001. Thesis: the commander of the northeast sector of the US Air Defense, NEAS, tried successfully at least 5 times to obstruct or slow down the military response to the hijackings on 9/11. We start with the acting persons. The chain of command on 9/11 looked like this: George W. Bush, Donald Rumsfeld, General Ross Eberhardt, Major General Larry Arnold, Colonel Robert Marr, Major Kevin Nisipany. Interestingly, the top of this chain of command was empty on 9/11. President Bush spent the morning in Florida and stayed out of the loop in terms of military orders. Secretary of Defense Donald Rumsfeld abandoned his post and was not available for his air defense subordinates during the attack. The real management of the air defense on the morning of 9/11 was actually in the hands of 2 men, even further down in the chain of command: Major Kevin Nisipany, mission crew commander at NEATS, and his direct superior, Colonel Robert Marr, commander of NEATS. The decisions of these 2 men had great effect on 9/11. It was in their direct responsibility to intercept the hijacked airliners with fighter jets. Unfortunately, one of them, the higher-ranking officer on the left, supposedly tried at least 5 times to obstruct this process. Here are the facts. Obstruction number 1. 2 fighter pilots at Otis Air Force Base, 300 kilometers northeast of New York, were alarmed and sat in their jets ready to start their engines at around 8:42, even before any hijacked plane had hit the World Trade Center towers. But then they had to wait. Colonel Marr, who could have ordered them to take off immediately, chose not to do that. He made an unnecessary phone call with his boss, General Arnold, instead. In effect, the order to take off was delayed for crucial 3 to 4 minutes. Without that delay, the pilots could possibly have intercepted the second hijacked plane, which crashed at 9:03. And here the quite remarkable flight route of these Otis jets, taking off finally at 8:52, according to official radar data. Obstruction number 2. At 9:09, after both of the towers were hit, Major Nisipany wanted to launch a second pair of fighters from Langley Air Force Base, 200 kilometers southeast of Washington, to place a barrier near the Capitol, a wise request. But Colonel Marr, his superior, refused this. In the end, the order to scramble the Langley jets was given no sooner than 9:24. 15 important minutes were lost. Had Marr ordered the scramble at 9:09 as requested, the jets could have reached the Pentagon before it was attacked at 9:37. Obstruction number 3. Captain Craig Borgstrom was the supervisor of flying at Langley Air Force Base. He was responsible for coordinating the Langley pilots during a mission, giving them orders from the ground, and maintaining the flow of information. Shortly before 9:24, he got a phone call from NEATS leadership, meaning Colonel Marr, ordering him to leave his coordination post on the ground and to take off as a third pilot. This was highly unusual, as an alert mission is always consisting of two fighters. The order brought actually no advantages for the air defense, but a major drawback. No officer was left on the ground to keep in touch with the Langley pilots. So when they were finally sent also in the wrong and unintended direction, not for Washington, but straight out to the east over the ocean, a scandal that remains even 10 years later still unexplained, by the way, nobody could reach them and tell them to turn around to save the Pentagon. With Bockstrom on the ground, this would have been no problem. Marr decided otherwise. And here is the strange flight route of the Langley fighters, taking off at 9:30, according to official radar data. Obstruction number 4. When Vice President Cheney ordered his shoot-down order, it was again Colonel Marr who decided not to convey this order to the pilots. In 2002 he also lied about this in a TV interview and offered no further explanation. That means, even if any fighter pilot had reached one hijacked airliner after this order had been given, he wouldn't have known that he had actually clearance to shoot. Colonel Marr had prevented it. Obstruction number 5. When the commander of Syracuse Air Base called Major Nisiponi to offer fighter jets, he stated that his pilots could be airborne within 15 minutes with hot guns. Nisiponi appreciated the offer. Hot guns? Well, that's good enough for me. And gave the Syracuse commander the phone number of his superior, Colonel Marr, if you want to talk to him. Syracuse did this and repeated the offer to Marr. Airborne with hot guns in 15 minutes, with heat-seeking missiles in 30 minutes, or with slammers, missiles with active radar, in an hour, because it would take some time to put these missiles on board. Marr chose the unnecessary, I want it all. So he delayed the start of the fighter jets again, as he had done it with the Otis pilots and then with the Langley pilots, as he had ordered Bockstrom away from his coordination post, and as he had prevented the transfer of the shoot-down order to the pilots. 5 obstructions and one man responsible. To clarify, with all these facts now available, it's of course still not proven that Colonel Marr made all these decisions in order to intentionally weaken the air defense. This is only a thesis so far. It could be false. But one thing is also clear. To get to the bottom of this, it needs a new public investigation of 9/11.